before I hand everything over to Reverend Greg, I just want to encourage you, if you, for those who weren't here on Sunday morning, you have to get the CD. If you get the CD and you listen to it, and listen to it, and listen to it, and get it in your heart, you'll never be defeated again. You have to get the CD. Amen. It was an amazing message. Amen. Angie,
yes.
Come on, you guys, come on over here.
I just asked her if we were asked to be moved out.
Okay. Come on, let's get together. Amen. As a family. So I want to encourage you, get the CD. Just see Brian after the service. Sunday morning was all about faith and how to operate faith. Amen. Simple application, believing, speaking. Amen. And if you can get what he's talking into your heart, and you live what he's talking about, amen, you'll never be the same. How many know the word works?
Amen.
The word works all the time. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, Reverend Greg, come and bless us with God's precious treasures, the words of his truth, Jesus, who was made flesh. Amen. Everybody give him a round of applause. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Reverend.
Thank you, Lord. I would chime in with Pastor Brad and get that CD from Sunday morning.
Yes, yeah.
You can go to my website and for 9 easy installments of $19.95, you
can get that CD. Only 10 installments here.
And don't
forget about 10 here.
Pardon me?
Only 10 installments here.
Oh, 10 installments. $19.95. There you go. On your Visa or MasterCard. Praise the Lord. No, I'm just kidding. We try to do as much as we can for free. And, now we're not able to do all of our messages on video, but we try to get many of them and put them on YouTube. I think we've got 30 or 40 videos up there, and we just put them up there for free, not charge them. Because if it's free, there's no excuse, right? Amen. And, there's some people that, they're hungry for the work, but maybe just at that moment, they just don't have the money to fork out or big bucks or, expensive books or tapes or whatnot. But my purpose and goal, and really our partners have helped us to do it, is we just make as much stuff for free as possible. Amen. Glory to God. Well, I want to talk for a few minutes tonight about something. Amen. And I actually borrowed a couple of pieces of scrap paper, and I did write down a couple of scriptures here. But go with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 2. 1 Corinthians chapter 2. Now, if you have a Bible, I really encourage you to bring your Bible to the services. If you don't have a Bible, let Pastor Brad know, and we'll find one for you. We'll get one for you. And he said there's lots here. So, you see, a lot of times what happens is, if you're just listening, you'll interpret the verse like you think it sounds. And maybe that's not exactly what it says. When you allow your eyes to see and register what the Word of God is saying, it makes all the difference in the world. Amen? And so, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, and I want to draw your attention to verse 10. Actually, verse 9, I look up and boy, that's a good verse too. So verse 9, it says, "But as it is written, eye has not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for them that love him. Now, oftentimes what people will do is they will interpret that as being when we get to heaven. Eye is not seen, ear is not heard. You can't even begin to imagine how wonderful heaven is. Alright? Now, that is true. Heaven is all of those things and more. Alright? But this isn't talking about heaven, you understand? That's talking about right now. This is right now. And the Bible says, it is to them that love Him. There are things that are available to you and I right now that you cannot even begin to imagine that's available to us. Alright? And it says here in verse 10, but God has revealed them unto us. What's the things that He's revealed to us? All these wonderful things that eyes not seen, the ears not heard, can't even begin to imagine. The Bible says God is in the business of showing us and revealing us these things that belong to us. Amen? And so we're not talking about philosophy or theory or ideas. We're talking about Bible fact and Bible truth. Alright? And it says here, but God's revealed them unto us by His Spirit. For the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God.
Hallelujah.
And last night, you know, after we had dinner, I just, you know, went over to the trailer and just wanted to get away. I'm finding that conversation is very grating to me. What do I mean with that? I've been spending extra time with the Lord, seeking the Lord, and I find it very difficult to have just regular conversations with people. It's like grating the fingernails on the chalkboard. To talk about, you know, boats or maybe just a little bit of that's okay, but I find myself more and more and more wanting to get away, just to, because see, there is a place in God called the deep. Amen. And there's not very many people that ever get to that place. But I want to be one of those that gets there. Amen. I want to be one of those that learns how to be in the deep. Just to be real honest with you. And the Bible says here that the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, even the deep things of God. Say that out loud, the deep things of God. And last night I went over to the trailer and just began to seek the Lord. Man, I was tired this morning. I didn't wake up until it was almost 10:30 this morning. But I had spent much of the night up and praying and seeking the Lord. And I really felt like the Lord was calling not just me, but us to a deeper place in Him. And that was something that I got in prayer last night, was that God was calling us to a deeper place in Him. And that's what I want to take a few minutes tonight and talk about, is to talk about the deep place of God. Amen. This was, I think it was last year now. I was watching Netflix, and there was a documentary about a filmmaker that wanted to explore the deepest depths of the ocean. And the further down you go, the greater the pressure is, the darker that it becomes. And they were finding that their equipment kept being wrecked and squished by the intense pressures that they were experiencing. And so finally, they actually had to develop technology to get down to the deeper parts of the ocean. And what they found is that there was life down there in the absolute crushing depths. But one thing about the deep was that, one, there was not very many people that ever went there. And those that did get there found it wasn't easy to get there. But it was worth getting there. Amen. And so, in looking at the deep things of God, I want us to look at, one, what it is, and then how to get there.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
Now, there is a realm in God. Now see, oftentimes, all some people's experiences with God is they pray the prayer, they come to church every once in a while, you know, they'll hear a Christian song on the radio every once in a while, and they think they're good. But there is a place in God that is uncomfortable for the flesh, but your spirit craves it. I'll never forget one time going to a meeting. It was in a person's home. And we're driving, there's several of us in a small van, and we're driving to this house meeting, And finally, I just chose to check out of the conversation and just, you know, close my eyes and just begin to meditate and to come to the presence of God. And so, man, I just tuned out everything that's going on in the vehicle, and we get to that meeting, and the Spirit of God fell in this house meeting. There was maybe 15, 20 people in this house meeting. And the presence of God came so strong, you literally wanted to die underneath the couch if you could fit. Amen? And I tell you, literally, it was like you had to pinch yourself. And I was saying to myself, Greg, you belong here. Because my flesh was very, very, there was such a manifestation of the presence of God, it was uncomfortable to the flesh, but yet my spirit craved it. And I don't want to say that you were afraid like a snake or a spider or, you know, one of those type of things, but there was such a reverence and a presence for God that your flesh almost wants to recoil a little bit. But your spirit craves that deeper place in God, amen? And so, what we've got to do is learn that you and I are not just flesh and blood beings. We are spiritual beings. Amen? We're spiritual beings. And one of the first steps in understanding the deeper things of God is to learn to operate out of your spirit. Amen? And one of the ways to do that is to deny your flesh certain rights and certain privileges. And see, we've all heard the term fasting. Maybe we'll skip a meal, or maybe we'll skip a few days of meals, and we're fasting. And that's okay, but you can live a whole lifestyle that's fasting. In other words, you don't ever allow your flesh to rise up above a certain level. Never eat all that you want. See, you say that some, and that is just such a foreign concept. But never allow yourself to gratify the flesh to a certain point, because I want my spirit to come into a deeper place of God. I want my spirit to rise up. See, I am a spirit. You are not the person that you see in the mirror. You're a spiritual being. When you get born again, it's not your flesh that's born again. It's not your mind that's born again. It's your spirit that's born again. And your spirit craves a relationship with God. Your spirit craves fellowship with God. And so, that's one reason why that people turn to drugs. They turn to alcohol. They turn to illicit relationships. They turn to all types of things because really, their spirit is craving something greater and something deeper. They don't know how to get there, and they're turning to these other things. And all they know how to do is to gratify the flesh. But really what it is, it's a spiritual hunger that will never be satisfied with anything in this natural realm. The only thing that will satisfy your spirit is spirit. And that's God. Amen? And so here, the Bible's talking about that the Holy Spirit searches all the deep things of God. Now go with me, if you would, to Luke 5. Luke 5. And I want to draw your attention to verse 4. Luke chapter 5, verse 4. Now, when he had left speaking, that's talking about Jesus, he said to Simon, launch out into the deep and let down your net for a drought or for a catch. And Simon answered and said unto him, Master, we've toiled all the night and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word, I will let down the net. Now, Simon Peter was a professional fisherman. He knew how to catch fish. He knew when the fish were active. He knew when they were not active. This is a time when they're not active. Everything in his professional brain said, we're wasting our time to go out and to catch more fish. And besides that, we worked all night long. And how many know, when you worked all night long, you're tired, you're hungry, you're grumpy, you're frumpy, and that is the least thing that you want to do. Amen? And so that was the situation that Jesus found himself in. He's telling Simon Peter, launch out into the deep for a catch. Now, there are churches and there are pastors that would say, we have done everything that we know what to do. We've tried every program, we've tried every gimmick, we've tried everything to get the church to grow, we've done everything, all right? And nothing has seemed to work. And what Jesus said is, you got to launch out into the deep. Amen? You never, ever suddenly find yourself in the deep. Jesus said, you got to launch out. Do you know what the word launch means? It means to shove off. To push out from the shore, to push out from your resting place, where you dock, where you put your boat, you shove off from there, and you make the effort to get out to a deeper place. You never just ever wind up, suddenly there you are in a deeper place. It takes effort. It takes work. Now, can I step on some people's toes?
Yes.
You'll never get there with your hands on the back of the pew. What do I mean by that? You'll never get to a deeper place doing the same old thing that you've been doing day after day, month after month, year after year. You'll never get any further than where you are now. Amen. You know what one of the definitions of insanity is? Is doing the same thing over and over again, but expecting a different result. Amen. At some point, you got to shove off. Amen. Now see, if I was in Oklahoma, I would say it differently. But see, up here in Canada, we're too polite, we're too nice, and but there's a song. Oh, I better not, I was stepping on your toes if I said that. But you get the, we need to shove off, is what I'm saying. Amen. Man, I would love to get blunt. I would love to just say it, Oklahoma, talk about it, I'll be nice, all right? At least for a little while. But we have to shove off. What does that mean? That means we release the grip from our safety zone. We release the grip from our comfort zone. We release the grip from what we know and what we're secure in. And we shove off into an area that we're unfamiliar with. Amen? That we shove off into an area that seems foreign to us. And that's the deeper place of God. Amen? It might mean that we need to move a little bit. It might mean that instead of just, you know, folding our arms and wondering, you know, how long they're going to sing that song over and over and over. How many times do it might mean that you have to shove off and get out of your head and maybe lift your hands. The Bible says to lift up holy hands without wrath and doubting. That is the Bible expression of worship, is lifting up holy hands. You might need to do that. You might need to move your feet a little bit. But get out of that rut. Get out of that comfort zone. Get out of that air. Well, you know, what if somebody sees me? It's just being carnal. You know, what will somebody think? Who cares what they think? Amen. I'm sure I haven't dealt with that before. Who cares what people say? Amen. But that's what Jesus told Peter, is you got to shove off. You got to launch out and leap. And sometimes it means you've got to make a concerted push to get the boat off the dock, off the shore, and out into a deeper place. So there's effort that's involved. There's strategy that's involved. I am coming, I am purposely coming to a deeper place in God. I will not settle for less than a deeper place in God. Amen? And so, thrusting out, launching out, shoving off, whatever term you want to use, that's what we do to get out into this deeper place in God. See, we get away from the comfort of the shoreline. You know, when you are out there, I mean, you are way out there in that body of water, there's more challenges that you'll face. I remember one time, there was a group of men from the church were out at Winifred Lake, and there was a sudden storm that come up, and suddenly, it went from, you know, sunny blue skies, and just a nice chop on the water, to Neil Hand was with me. He was in my boat. I'm on the motor. It got so bad, he hit his knees on the floor of that boat, and he was praying. Because our lives were in peril in a matter of minutes. And there was such a whirl of wind, visibility, and rain, you could not barely see past the front of the boat. I didn't know whether we were going north, south, east, or west. The motor was getting swamped with the waves. It was literally powerless in that storm. And now when you're flying, now I'm taking flight lessons, when you're flying, there's something called spatial disorientation, where you just don't know up from down or right from left. It's almost like you're lost in an instant. And that's what happened up there on the water. Until a tiny little window opened in the rain and storm, and I saw the light at the end of the dock. And I hit that bow of the boat, and we're just heading towards what we know was safety. But see, out there in the deep, things can happen. And there might be some people that would feel uncomfortable to ever get out there in the deep. But that's also where the big fish were. Very few ever catch the trophy off the dock. Oh, you might catch a perch. You might catch the stick fish or the salmon fish, but you'll probably never catch a trophy off the dock. You gotta get out there in the deep. Amen. You see, there is things available to us, but the Spirit God said, and He's revealing these things to us. There are things in the spiritual realm that are only available to us by getting into the deeper places in God. Only available there. Like, for instance, you know, there's been a lot of talk about the glory of God. And I got special permission from a certain pastor to share this testimony about the glory of God. This was while the pastor and his wife were going to Bible school. They went to Jerison Hills Bible School down in Fort Worth, Texas. And they were learning the principles of faith and learning the principles of healing and different things. And the pastor's wife's brother served in the military, U.S. military, and suffered a condition called PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, from things they had seen in combat. And his mental condition literally spiraled so far down, he didn't even know his own name anymore. And was literally being reduced to a vegetable state. And so they got permission to bring him to stay with them in their apartment while they're going to Bible school to take care of him. And so they're endeavoring to believe God for his healing. And one day he is sitting in the kitchen, and the pastor and his wife, now they were pastors then, they're just Bible students, but they're sitting on the couch in the living room. And they're praying. And suddenly, something like a mist began to form in the kitchen dining room area. Until it absolutely covered this man. I mean, the whole place turned just like a cloud where this man was sitting. He's enveloped in this cloud. And he begins to say, "It's going all over me. It's going all over me. It's going all over me." And he falls out of the chair onto the floor of the, you know, kitchen area. The pastor and his wife, they're pinned to the couch. They cannot even move. They cannot move. Finally, when the last little wisp of that cloud and that glory lifted off from the brother, they were able to move off the couch. And when they reached the brother, he was completely healed in his right mind and totally restored. Amen. There are things that are available in the deeper places of God. Amen. I crave those things. I crave deeper experiences with God. You know, we get excited about miracles and stuff like that, and rightly that we should. But there are things that are so far beyond that. See, miracles are wonderful, but they don't produce faith. Jesus had more miracles than probably any other human being on the planet. And there even came a time with him when people didn't follow him anymore. So it's not about miracles, it's about truth, it's about the Word of God. That's what's important. But there are things that you and I can experience in the realms of God that even supersede the miraculous. Amen. There's manifestations of the glory, there's manifestations of His presence that will even supersede the cripples walking and being healed. Now, don't get me wrong, I'm not against cripples walking and getting healed. We want to see that lots.
Amen.
Amen. But there's things that are still available in the presence of God. You know, I was holding a service in New Brunswick, actually in my dad's church, and it was like somebody walked up to me. Now, I didn't look to see who it was, but it was as real to me. Now, I'm walking up to her. Now, do you know that I'm here? Yeah, of course you do. Now, close your eyes. Do you still realize that I'm here? Obviously, I'm here, all right? Now, it was as real to me, even though I was not looking, somebody walked up and whispered in my ear, "The almost disciple." And God gave me a supernatural message about God's will and plan for you to prosper. To me, That was something deep.
Yeah.
Amen. I was actually in the same church, different time, different occasion. And man, I didn't know what this was. And Brother Ian Flurry, he's a standing office teacher. He's one of the people on our board. And he began to talk. And while he's talking, the Holy Ghost revealed to me what it was that I experienced. I had my eyes shut. We're worshiping God in praise and worship. And suddenly to my left, it was a... Now, that my eyes were closed, it was a spiritual vision. I saw an absolutely bright passageway. And that passageway moved and came right up to me. And I reached in that passageway and I grabbed the message for that night and preached that message. And, but I had no clue what it is. My brain was just tripping with that. And Brother Ian's up there just talking away, sharing away. And he mentioned, Jean Wilkerson, who was a prophetess of God just back, 40 years ago. And she mentioned going through the veil of the Spirit, getting the Word of God, the message of God, and bringing it to the people. That's exactly what happened that night. Revelation. See, that was a deeper thing of God. That was a deeper. I like those type of things. Amen. Now, one thing about the deeper places of God, you've got to be grounded in the Word of God to experience the deeper places of God. Because there are things that will trip your brain. I mean, just tilt. Amen. If we're not grounded in the Word of God, people that are not grounded get flaky and weird and just spooky, so to speak, if I can use those terms. When I was going to Bible school, we called them granola bar Christians because they were nothing but fruits and nuts and flakes. Amen. But when you're grounded in the Word, then you can have deeper experiences and not get off balance. And that's important to understand that. Go with me, if you would, to the book of Genesis real quick. And we're going to look at a man quickly that found the deeper place of God. His name was Enoch. And go with me to Genesis chapter 5 and verse 21. And Enoch lived 65 years and began Methuselah. And Enoch walked with God after he began Methuselah 300 years, and begat sons and daughters, and all the days of Enoch were 365 years, and Enoch walked with God, and was not, for God took him. Does that mean God killed him? No, the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 11 that by faith Enoch walked with God and was translated so that he wouldn't see death. Amen? Now, here's a man that in the midst of generation after generation after generation of people living and dying, all of a sudden here's a man that walked with God. Now, how many of you have taken the time to read all those genealogies here in Genesis? Man, I struggle through. So-and-so against so-and-so, lived and died, how many, hundreds of years, and they lived and died. Now, I finally found something that makes sense. I found an actual linear timeline of all those generations. Adam, lived 930, whatever it was, 900 some years. 930. Adam was about 600 years old when baby Enoch came on the scene. Enoch and Adam lived for 300 some years at the same period of time. So what does that mean? It means that Adam was a great grandfather of Enoch. Now, how many of you have seen Curtis? Helen's son Curtis. And that baby adores his grandpa Curtis. And I mean, even at what? How many weeks old is he?
Seven
months old. I mean, just you can see the attachment already to his grandpa. And the same, you know, with Aubrielle. I mean, she just comes bolting in and grabs her grandpa. And so, here's Enoch, who was a grandson of Adam. I mean, the original grandpa. Now, one thing. Now, I'll use my grandpa, for instance. I absolutely loved, as a little kid growing up, hearing about the old-time stories that my grandpa used to tell. I loved them. There was, you know, here's one particular gentleman, forget his name, and he had gone up into Ontario, and he was walking around the lake and disappeared. And now, this is my little childlike mind, that there were peoples that lived out there in the wilderness that nobody had ever seen before, and they captured them and ate them. And this was Ontario, you know, like back in the 40s. And so, but I'm hearing these stories, and my mind is just going wild. And then I would hear about Doyle Short, who was a great big tall guy. And I would hear about Lucky the Great Big Buck, and all these tremendous stories. And I was spellbound. I was thrilled to hear all these stories. Even this day, and my grandma's going to heaven now, but I still think about those, and they're still precious to me. All right? So just use your spiritual imagination for a moment tonight, if you would. And imagine little Enoch going up and sitting on his great 300 times grandpa's lap. And saying, "Grandpa, please, please tell me the story again of when you and grandma were in the garden. I want to hear about it." See, among the Jews, they have what's called the oral tradition. It's a relating and a passing down of history by mouth. This is where it came from. And so, just imagine, you know, Adam put his arm around Enoch, because for 300 years, he got all the stories. And just imagine, if you would, here's Adam saying, "Oh, son, it was so wonderful. God made this beautiful garden, but I was by myself. But I would talk to the Lord, and I would visit with him, and I was in the garden. And then one day, God put me to sleep and performed the first surgery on me and took a rib out of me and made your grandma. And whoa, was she some woman. Whoa, man. And you talk about, well, never mind. But that's part of the story. That's part of the story. And we enjoyed the garden, and God brought to us all the animals, and whatever I called the animal, that's what it was. Even if it was the funniest sounding name you ever heard of, like giraffe, or rhinoceros. Yeah. or alligator, whatever, all these names, whatever I called them, that's what God called them. And that's what they were known as. And God gave us everything that we could ever desire in that garden. We were able to eat of all the fruit of the trees. It was so wonderful. And there were greens like they'd never seen green before. There were blues like they never saw blue before. The water was so fresh and crystal clear like they'd never seen before. And I can just imagine Enoch's imagination just running wild with the beauty and the splendor and the majesty of this place that God created and put Adam and Eve in the midst of it. And I can imagine Enoch saying, but as beautiful and as wonderful as all that wasn't our favorite part. The most wonderful part of being in that garden, it was in the evening. When that sun would begin to go down lower in the horizon, and the wind changed, and you could feel that cool breeze. And suddenly, the one who made it all would come and visit us. And we would talk with him. And we would walk with him. And the most wonderful time of our entire existence was when we would come and listen to him. And he would listen to us. And we fellowship with him. We walk with him and we talk with him. The one that made the earth, the one that made the stars, the one that made the sun and the moon. He was the best part of it all. And I can just imagine Enoch saying, well, where is he today? Well, God doesn't do that today. Because we disobeyed him. And we had to leave that wonderful, beautiful place. And I can just imagine a fire being ignited in Enoch to say, I want to know him. My grandpa and grandma did. I want to walk with him. I think it. But all he ever knew was, God doesn't do that anymore. That happened years ago, son, but not anymore. And I can just imagine Enoch just one day calling out. Maybe he's walking down the road. Maybe he's walking out of the pasture, out in the field somewhere, just looking up to heaven, looking up in the blue sky. Just say, God, I believe you're there. I'd like to know you like Grandpa did. I'd like to walk with you like Grandma did. But there was just nothing but the sound of the breeze. Grass waving. Maybe leaves blowing. Just his own voice echoing off in the distance. And he went out there again the next day. God, I want to know you. I want to walk with you. I want to experience you like my grandpa did. But there was nothing but the sound of his own voice. But you know what? When you're hungry, it doesn't stop you. When you're passionate, you don't get deterred, and you don't lose your focus. And he went out there day after day after day. God, I want to know you. God, I want to walk with you. I want to experience you like Grandpa did, like Grandma did. But nothing. But he kept going, and he kept going, and he kept going, and he kept going, day after day, month after month, possibly year after year after year. And one day, something changed. He's out there in that field, if you just imagine it with me. And that sun began to set in the western sky. And the light began to turn gold. And that breeze just began to cool off ever so slightly. And that wind hit him on the back of the neck, and every hair on his head stood up. Because there was a presence in that wind that he had never known before. He had only heard stories. He had only heard the testimony of his grandpa and grandma. And God showed up to a man that refused to take no for an answer. He's walking with God. And for 300 years, he walked with that God and talked with that God and experienced his glory, experienced his presence. And the Bible says in Hebrews 11, he did it by faith. Amen. By faith, Enoch walked with God. Amen. You can't walk with God just because of your feelings or your emotions. You make a decision, I'm going all out for God. No matter what it takes, no matter if it takes me day after day and month after month and year after year, I'm not quitting until I get there. I'm not stopping until we get there. Amen. I won't settle for anything less than the glory and the presence of God. Amen. God wants to walk with us. He wants us to be in that place with us. Amen. And he is abounding to us with his grace, with his mercy, with his presence, with his power, with his glory, if we'll just walk with him. Amen. That's why I said the other day, I don't care about beautiful sunsets. I don't care about how gorgeous the lake is here. I don't care about this, you know, how warm the weather is. I don't care about that because I got a taste of the same God that Enoch walked with. And I'm not satisfied without him. I'm not satisfied without his glory. I'm not satisfied without his power. I don't want Mickey Mouse services. I don't want to just, you know, well, we're just coming to the service and we got our hands on the back of the chairs and, you know, move me if you can. There's something better available. Amen. And God is wanting to abound to you and I with everything that he is, with everything that he has, with the whole of heaven right now. Not just when we get to heaven, we can have heaven on earth right now. Amen. You might say, well, you know, what's revival? I don't know. But I do know I want him. That's what I do know. You know, what's God doing? He's wanting us to come to a deeper place. He's given us the invitation to come. But it's not the type of thing where, you know, I can just go and lay hands on you and suddenly you're there. I wish I could, if I could do that, I would do that. Trust me, I assure you, I would do that. That would be easy. But sometimes it means, you know, here we're enjoying a beautiful steak dinner. Brad made steaks on the grill. I like steak. But I want the presence of God more. Amen. You know, I like heaven. I like heaven. And I would love to just, you know, sit down and visit with her and just hear everything about what's going on. I would love to hear all that. But there's something I need more. And that's the presence of God. Amen. That glory, and some of you haven't seen them in years. I would love to just catch up, but and it's not that you can't do that sometimes, but in this setting here, we need God. We need the glory of God. And we need the presence of God. How many of you would say, Brother Greg, I want that deeper place.
Yeah.
I do. You got to make a commitment. You know, I've shared this type of thing about Enoch before, and man, it gets me every single time. And one time I asked the Lord, I said, Lord, why does that affect me so much? I mean, I've never been able to talk about Enoch without tears coming to my eyes and getting all snotty nose. You know, why, Lord? And one day he spoke to me. He said, because that's exactly how it happened. Isn't that so simple? Isn't that so simple? He said, that's exactly how it happened. I never forgot that. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. No need to stop. Praise the Lord. See, that's also a deeper thing of God, too. It's happy. It is. Read Psalm 126. Thank you, Lord. Pastor's looking for it. Thank you, Lord. You find it?
Yes.
Read it out loud. Use a microphone.
When the Lord brought back the captivity of Zion, we were like those who dream. Then our mouth was filled with laughter and our tongue was singing. And they said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us, whereof we are glad. Bring back our captivity, O Lord, as the streams in the south. Those who sow in tears shall reap in joy. He who continually goes forth weeping, bearing seed for sowing, shall doubtless come again with rejoicing, bringing his sheaves with him.
Why were they laughing? Because the Lord had done great things for them. Has the Lord done anything good for you? Has the Lord done anything good for you? Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Keep the place open. Solomon, boy, your Bible's different than mine. That's it right now. Psalm 126. Why not? Now, read the first First three verses. Yeah, put your glasses on. Here. 126, verse 1 to 3.
When the Lord brought back the captivity of Zion, we were like those who dream. Then our mouth was filled with laughter, and our tongue was singing. Then they said amongst the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us, whereof we are glad.
Does it say that we're sad?
No.
Amen. It's okay to be glad.
Amen.
Go ahead, Alex. Go ahead, just read the verse.
Okay.
You might say, well, you know, why is he laughing? Because it's deep. First three verses.
126?
Yeah.
Okay. When the Lord brought back the captivity of Zion, we were like those who dream. Then our mouth was filled with laughter. Yeah. Okay. And our tongue would sing. Then they said among the captives,
hallelujah. Here, you give it a try. Right there, verse 1, 2, and 3.
When the Lord brought back the captivity of Zion, we were like those who dream. Then our mouth was filled with laughter and our tongue was singing. And they said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us. We are glad.
See, it's scriptural to be glad.
Yes.
It's scriptural to be glad. It's scriptural, go ahead, to laugh. Amen. How many's ever just laughed before? You don't even have to have a comedian. You don't even have to have a joke. All you gotta know is that the Lord's done good things for you. What's the Lord done for you? What's something good that the Lord's done for you? Tell me something good that the Lord's done for you.
So many.
Yeah.
When the doctors wrote ourselves that we can have children, those who put to us about having four kids, the mother of one and my wife, and then we got married, and nothing happened for 7 years.
Yeah.
And everybody said, nothing's gonna happen. But I said, I believe God, I heard from God, it's gonna happen the way it is.
Mm-hmm.
Today I have three boys, and this one.
Alright. Has done good things, given them family, given them children. Amen. So what do you do when you realize God's done something good? Ha 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 ha
ha ha ha ha ha ha ha ha
ha ha ha ha.
Amen.
Now you might say, well, that's just foolish. No, it's going deeper. See, the flesh wants to not do that. Amen. Ha, 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 ha. Come here, sister.
Me?
Yeah, what's the Lord done something good for you? Yeah. word she said was, every day.
Every day.
Every day. God's doing something every day. So every day, we should be ha, 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 ha. Ha, 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 ha. And just start laughing.
Yeah.
Amen.
Look
in the mirror. Lord, come out here. Praise the Lord. What's something good that the Lord has done for you?
He brought me home.
Amen.
He brought me back. He brought my daughter back.
Yeah.
My granddaughter. And
Rebecca, come up here and bring your daughter with you. Amen. Because they are something good.
Yes.
There's something to laugh about. Amen.
Yeah.
You guys are something to laugh about.
Yes.
No, not that we're laughing at you.
No.
But that's the very reason that we can laugh, because the devil, he hates everybody. He hates everybody. And his only goal is to steal and kill and destroy. Well, what did God do? He brought us home.
He brought us home.
He did.
It was time.
Yes.
Amen. So, go ahead and just take a lap of the devil. Just a little bit. Might as well get in and enjoy.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Might as well get in and enjoy. Praise the Lord. You don't need a special invitation. Might as well get in and enjoy. Thank you, Lord. On the day of Pentecost, somebody find Acts chapter 2 and says, what does it say? In the Holy Ghost. You might as well. Who wants to get drunk tonight? Hallelujah. And yet, well, then let's just get drunk tonight. I think I'm okay for you. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Miss Kim, leave the piano and come down here. But you don't have to have music to be drunk and have a good time in the Lord. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Shut up, brother. Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, what's the hell in the
chat?
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hand me that blood a little bit, right? Somebody. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
I'm okay. I'm leaving alone.
What's the matter? I'm honest, officer. I'm honest, because you're broke.
Receive. you back.
Oh, you're welcome.
We'll see you now.
I just need to, I know, I'm...
Out of your belly, will flow rivers of living water. Taste, taste and drink it in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. The anointing of God, the anointing of God, the anointing of God, the anointing of God. It's anointing, brother, it's anointing. Be filled. Ha, 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 thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. How are you doing, Miss Kim? Your eyes look different. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Oh, thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Ha ha ha!
comes. And the spirit he departs. And here dwelling at Jerusalem, devout man.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Glory to God. You know what? To be honest with you, though, to be drunk in the Lord is an amazing experience. It's just pure 100% honey joy. Amen. You know, Proverbs 28 says that when the righteous do rejoice, there's great glory. Amen. Psalm 67 says this, then the earth will yield its increase.
Yes.
So if we would learn to rejoice, if we would learn to be glad, because our hope is in Him, and remember, hope is expectation. If we know that we know that we know, and really, that's hope. Did you hear that? If you know that you know that you know that you know, that's your hope, that's your expectation. Because all He wants me to do is rejoice.
Amen.
And when we rejoice, there's great glory.
Yes, amen.
And then the earth yields its increase in your life. How many want increase?
Oh,
amen. In every area. Every area.
Yeah.
Amen. So tonight we're going to take up a love offering for our dear brother who's went to bed a little early tonight. And we will tuck him in. He's safe and sound in the hands of the Lord. For God is his refuge and his fortress. So we are very excited and delighted with God's doing. What we experienced tonight is just a little taste, Erica, of what's coming. I've been in the presence of God where it's so strong I had to ask Him to quit because I couldn't take it anymore. Just pure joy. We are in revival. The winds of revival are blowing. Amen. Hallelujah. So just take a minute just to ask the Holy Spirit. I mean, you know, we understand that you can't give every night, but if you can give to bless the Lord by blessing Greg, amen, you know what? It comes back on you, right?
Amen.
We live in a dispensation of seed time and harvest time. Whatever goes around comes around. They call it karma now. Isn't that right, Pastor Dave? They call it karma.
Yeah.
So whatever goes around comes back, amen. And I'm telling you, it works. Amen. It works. So if you need an envelope, there's one right there. There's a pen also. Amen. Hallelujah. Just write it out to Triumph Life Center. If you want to pay by debit, you can pay by debit and just go to the back afterwards and stick the little receipts in the envelope and Shem will take care of you. Great things are coming. Wonderful things. You can expect wonderful things. Saturday night we had a service here, and there was a gentleman that we ended up praying for after the service back in the fellowship hall, and he had a pinched nerve in his neck, and he's been on pills to help with circulation, and so we just commanded that nerve to go back in its normal place, and within minutes, the numbness left his hands and his legs. Want to do what we want to We want to document the miracles. We want to ask you if you'll come forward.
You don't forget.
Okay, God
loves you. We love you. Amen. Faith worketh by love. Bring somebody tomorrow night.